sustainability of growth and development has been of concern, because in most cases, we have actually had what we call economic growth, but we have actually not had economic development. Africa has grown with respect to having 7%, 6%, 5%, consistently over time. But despite the growth that Africa have had, the challenges of inequality, the challenges of rising poverty, and the challenges of rising unemployment has actually reduced the growth to nothing. Because if the continent is growing 5%, 6%, 7% consistently, we expect the fact that inequality should be reducing, poverty should be reducing, and unemployment should be reducing. But these are basically not the set of issues for Africa. So as a result of that, the African Union came together and then said that, okay, let us look at the situation whereby we can transform African economy. And one of the ways is, one of the issues in terms of the Agenda 2063 that the African Union actually brought together in terms of having what they call the Africa we want, in terms of structurally transforming the African continent. And this was also done in the context of the sustainable development goals, that we can actually use this to eradicate inequality as well as poverty in the continent of Africa. But at the same time, the environmental issues were brought under the United Nations 21st Conference of the Parties, known as COP21, in order to also affect the environment and take the environment issue in our development into consideration. So basically, we all know that industrialization always comes with the side effects. Industrialization is not a standalone factor. It always comes with a side effect, such that when you try to industrialize, you know, you are trying to create more jobs, you are trying to alleviate poverty, but it's also going to come with some unintended effects. It's not just going to sit alone and then just develop industrializing. You're going to have pollution. The air is going to be polluted. The water is going to be polluted. The soil is going to be polluted because of emissions that come from these industrial activities. And then again, you're going to affect your water, you're going to have water scarcity, and then you're going to have energy supply deficit, because in most of the cases, energy is concentrated to those industrial areas. So as a result of that, we felt that creating the economy through a move away from the fossil fuel dependency to renewable energy is critical for sustainable development. Because if actually we want to develop, we want Africa to develop in a sustainable manner, in which poverty is reduced, in which inequality is reduced, and which unemployment is reduced. So, but if you say you want to define green industry or green economy or green industrialization, you may not be able to have a specific definition for it. But the context of the discussion on green industry usually focuses on some of these defining attributes. And what are those defining attributes in terms of the one, sustainably produced inputs, the one, minimal use of virgin raw materials, the one, production process free from harmful toxins, we want to reduce and recycle solid waste streams in the context of eco-responsibility and eco-efficiency. You want products that are built for longevity and durability and substantial reduction in emission or effluence of harmful greenhouse gases. So, if you can have all this, then that means we are trying to work in the path of a green industrialization development. So, but why does Africa need to go green in terms of its industrialization? So if we look at the continent quite clearly and quite carefully, the continent seems to be dominated with respect to certain strategic issues that's common to almost all the African countries. And one of them is the fact that the African economy is largely agrarian in nature. It's dominated by agriculture from Benin to Niger, from Gabon to Guinea. Everywhere is basically agriculture dominated. Then African economies are resource dependent. If it is not crude oil, it is copper, it is not copper, it is cocoa, it is not cocoa, it is cotton. So we only depend mostly on our natural resources for our economic sustenance. Then again, energy is quite scarce in Africa because of the infrastructural deficits, because of energy deficits that we actually have. Then water seems to constrain African growth paths. So that is why we now said that given this set of conditions, Africa needs to adopt a green growth strategy in which we can use green industrialization to achieve economic transformation. Because one of the opportunities that the green industrialization will do is that to promote goods, it will create employment and also reduce poverty, which basically and doesn't come with all intended effects which the brown industry definitely brings about to Africa. But whatever we are trying to do with respect to this, even at the level of green industry, we must avoid the mistakes of emerging countries such as China that actually made fossil fuels and natural resources incompatible. Because when you go to China today, you see a lot of smokes on the air. That the environment is being degraded and they are actually industrially competitive. But at what cost? These are some of the challenges that we feel that Africa must avoid in terms of its growth path. So, there are arguments in the competing literature that the green industry, is it a trade-off or a win-win situation? One of the facts is that greening the economy is a luxury that only richer countries can afford. That poor countries should develop first and clean up later. That government doesn't really have the rule. Government should stand up. That should not do anything at the moment. And let the market economy operate without incomes. That is, everything should be left to the forces of demand and supply. And let them find its equilibrium. The government doesn't have the rule on that particular scenario. The poor countries don't have any business in food, and African countries are trying poor. That's the first part of the argument. But another part of the argument comes that if you neglect the environment today, that may have unintended consequences on the current and the future growth for such an economy. That the environment should also be taken into the consideration today. The second issue then comes to the fact that social inclusion can be dealt with after the important business of economic growth has been achieved through taxes and redistribution. So the first one is that we don't have a business. This is the first argument that it's a luxury that only richer countries can afford. And then it comes to the fact that it cannot be dealt with, it cannot bring in social inclusion after the important business of economic growth has been achieved. But again, there are arguments against that too, that it's always difficult to track pollution, but most of the companies or industrial firms that emit pollution to the air, it's always difficult to track them. And then to also make them pay, because we lack the institutions in Africa to be able to achieve abatement or pollution penalties. So we have our gross domestic product that doesn't actually give insight into environmental degradation. So people have actually been asking, how long might environmental destructive growth be worthwhile before the fruits of rapid growth can be used to clean up the mess? That are we going to still not invest in green industrialization and let the environment continue to be degraded? Or are we going to start working round the clock to make sure that As you are trying to develop industrially, you are also preserving the environment in terms of greening industrialization. So, because the major reason why we need to look into the perspective of green industrialization is the challenges that African countries are currently facing with respect to World Trade Organization and other international trade agreements in the context of the economic partnership agreements, trade-related investment measures, trade-related intellectual property rights. So this seems to have actually locked Africa down into the global framework of underdevelopment. So that is why green industry is coming in handy. And as a result of that, governments are focusing on promoting capabilities to enable the enterprises to compete in global value chains, promote technical and economic innovation, develop new sectors with respect to new green industry and also diverse technologies. But if actually we want the green industry to have the specific effects that we actually want it in Africa, inclusion must be brought in into green industry. Because for the brown industry that we have actually been using before, the level of inclusion is very, very low. Because that is when we will be able to tackle poverty, inequality, and exclusion that constrains growth. It's only when people are actually included that the level of poverty and the level of inequality will be drastically reduced. And then we need to realize women's and men's aspiration and to address the needs of different regions and gain broad political support. So it must be people oriented. And because of the fact that we have the natural resources in abundance, then definitely it will be an inclusive strategy that Africa can actually use. So basically, it's obvious now that the growth process as a whole, not specific, can stand alone. The green industry investment must come into the green industry, and the government must be able to support the green industry. So basically, bringing industrialization, greening, and inclusion together actually shows the fact that government must be responsible for each area of policy design, implementation, and funding. Because when we are talking about it, the protection of industries such as manufacturing has been done, we need to talk either to the likely impact on low-income groups or the environmental factors such as pollution of water, energy, and air. So we always want to develop. And as much as the fact that we are developing, we don't take care of the environment. If you take the cement industry, almost all economies in Africa are trying to protect it. But what does it do for the environment? It creates pollution. It affects the water system and also affects the air environment around it. So, overlapping industrialization, greening, and inclusion offers a timely opportunity for the African continent. So this is just like an example. If you look at it, this is the green growth. It's being pursued alone as a standalone. And this is industrialization. It's being taken as a standalone. And this is inclusive growth. It's also being taken as a standalone. None of them is actually feeding into each other. But if you have a situation whereby we allow our green growth to feed into our industrialization, and we also bring in inclusiveness into the middle of the two, then we can have a three-round framework of green and inclusive industrialization, which means that we cannot pursue one of them without bringing in the other. The three of them must be simultaneously pursued. And the only possibility that can be actually pursued is when it is done within the green industrialization framework. So the green industrialization pathway offers a valuable opportunity to combine economic growth, more inclusive incomes, and an enhanced environment with green economic strategy. So how do we achieve green industrialization? By trying to move out of brown industries. by bringing existing industry, by increasing resource productivity, cutting pollution, and managing chemicals more safely. Because that's part of the challenges we are having at the moment. We don't manage our waste. We still allow such waste to continue to affect the environment. And then we need to create new green enterprise, such as producing green capital goods, generating renewable energy, and providing environmental advisory services. So we can actually look at this from what's called decoupling. That is, we are reducing our level of material intensity. We are reducing our level of material intensity in achieving economic growth, which I try to call a relative decoupling. And we can even still go further with the right technology into the absolute decoupling, whereby we reduce our overall use of materials that can harm the environment. Therefore, the pathway to green and inclusive industrialization in Africa must be shaped by three considerations. First, the green growth agenda cannot be reduced to minimizing carbon emission. For the COP21, it's trying to look at reducing emission to 2 degrees Celsius, and that has been basically the focus of most countries in Africa. We want to reduce emission in order to reduce the impact of the climate. But going green or green industrialization is not limited to just reducing CO2 emission and other form of emissions. Although it is an important part of green goods, but there's also the need to protect Africa's scarce and fragile water resources. We need to actually take into consideration the Africa's fragile water resources to minimize pollution and enhance the quality of developmental outcomes, or the quality of employment and of economic inclusion. Number two, there will always be trade-offs when we are trying to move from one industry to another industry. Within the short term, that we want to actually achieve economic growth. But then in the future, in the long term, there will be multiple opportunities that can now lead to a win-win situation. So in the short run, we have some form of challenges. But in the long run, there are those three opportunities that will lead to a win-win situation that cannot bring about more equitable and more sustainable patterns of growth. Third, the green growth agenda is not a 5-year challenge. It is something that takes 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. Because they actually took those developed economies of China, France, Japan, United States, Britain, quite a while to be able to develop. So it requires the formulation of long-term policy and resource commitments in order to be able to manage the green industrialization agenda. Basically, a lot of African countries have actually made efforts in managing the implementation of an inclusive green economy. Ethiopia has been able to manage the climate resilient green economy. Kenya has achieved the green economy strategy and implementation plan. There's a Green Morocco plan. Then Mozambique has a roadmap for a green economy. South Africa has a green economy accord. Rwanda, green growth and climate resilience. While Ghana has a progression. African countries have actually key into it. There's a plan among all the set of African countries in order to be able to use the green part of industrialization in order to develop their economy. But given the fact that they actually have the plan, implementation of those plans seems to be the issue that we are actually having at the moment. So, and I said that, okay, do we actually want to continue with the business as usual, or we want to continue with the green agenda? Because if you say business as usual in Africa, we are talking about current growth trajectory continues without affecting inequality, without affecting unemployment, without affecting poverty. With uneven patterns of development, only South Africa is going, Togo is ongoing, Guinea is not going, Gabon is ongoing. Sporadic approaches to natural resource waste and energy management. But if African industrialization is green, we'll be able to target improvement to urbanization, energy we develop, the money for digital growth, and then change to the very basis of our economy. So the problem has always been, do we actually want to do the business as usual strategy, or we actually want to go with the green agenda strategy? But one of the critical challenges that Africa is facing at the moment is the financing of green industrialization. It's a whole basic issue because the amount that Africa requires in order to be able to finance the transformative, inclusive, and green growth is huge. In the next in the next 20 to 25 years, Africa will consistently need around $50 billion a year to be able to implement the green growth agenda. We need to focus on renewable energies and resource efficient technologies, water and waste management system, as well as the prevention of climate related disasters. So basically, we need the support of the South-South Corporation, the public-private partnership, as well as access to the climate finance in order to be able to manage the green growth agenda. And large renewable energy projects must be sponsored, and their financing depends on long, strong policy framework. This is where the financial institution, such as African Development Bank, the Development Bank of South Africa, and African Finance Corporation, we actually need to come in order to support the African continent. Because between 2040, we need nothing less than $360 billion in order to affect the infrastructure needs of the African continent. So, the public-private partnership began the important source of infrastructure funding, and basically the South-South Corporation can also be a very good opportunity in affecting our management or getting financial opportunities to finance this green growth industrialization. So, in short, a green industrialization agenda cannot be pursued by one set of stakeholders alone. It must be the effort of different stakeholders, such as civil society organization, the government, the private sector, as well as developing partners. This means that funders must act in concert. The government of each country cannot do it alone. It will make efforts, but it needs to be complemented by the private sector as well, and development support coming in from our developing partners. So we need to have a strategic rethink across Africa to achieve our structural transformation, to build on much stronger domestic and regional linkages, reducing impact from climate change and improving use of renewable resources, particularly water and energy. Together, those global agreements, the COP21 and the SDG, and in the 2063, a market shift confirm a direction of travel for the global economy towards a low carbon future based on green and inclusive growth. Worldwide, a growing number of countries have seen the green growth agenda not as an obstacle and a threat, but as the next big opportunity for growth and transformation. In conclusion, I look at the fact that the green economy train has been running at full speed due to several factors, including innovative technology, which are bringing down the cost of renewables considerably, because that's basically one of the challenges that people are talking about. The initial cost of going green is very, very high, but basically what you save out of it can now actually allow you to go into sustainable development efforts. The belief among African development experts is that going green and clean. Because you don't just go green alone. You also need to be clean about the source of energy. It's no longer a moral question. It's now a socioeconomic imperative. It's like what I call the next pathway to African industrialization. Given the lockdown that the WTO has actually put us, given the lockdown that aid-related development assistance have actually locked down on, and given the fact that we want an Africa that we want, in which we can have consistent reduction in poverty, consistent reduction in inequality, and consistent reduction in unemployment, that can actually bring us to grow in a sustainable manner. Thank you very much.